Hey, physicists, today we're going to talk about rotational motion, specifically kinematics. So objects rotate around a fixed axis. This would be objects rotating around a fixed axis. And we're looking at maybe something like this up here in the top right corner, where you have the object that is spinning around that circle. Whoops, spinning around the circle. When we do that, we would normally measure this in degrees when we're in linear motion, but when we're in angular motion, we're going to measure it with our angle value, and that is going to be in radians. So remember that one trip around the circle will be 2 pi r, and the ratio of that 2 pi r to r is the theta value or the radians that we would have. So one important value that you would want to remember is this 360 degrees is the same as 2 pi radians, which is the same as one revolution. 360 degrees, 2 pi radians, one revolution. Now, remember, if you remember from the last video, whenever we did the cover sheet for angular motion, if you can think of this in terms of linear, then it makes the angular really, really, really easy. So the linear, I have this position, a velocity, and an acceleration. In angular, I have a position, a velocity, and an acceleration. So my angular position is theta. It's how far around the circle it goes. Omega is my angular velocity. It's how fast it's going around that circle, or how fast it's rotating. And then the alpha is the angular acceleration, which is saying how quickly that velocity is changing. Now, remember, the way we convert these is we multiply by the radius times the angular to give us the linear. Then when we look at the equations, don't forget that the equations are the same. So I have x equals vt plus 1/2 at squared, vf, viat, vf squared, vi squared, 2ax. And remember that each of those values mirror the value of the angular and the linear. So the linear position is x, the angular position is theta, the linear velocity is v, the angular velocity is omega, and you can just plug in all of those values. So you're not really memorizing three more equations. You're just looking at the three you know already and mentally filtering them into an angular value. So to summarize, remember that theta is how far around the circle it goes. It's similar to a distance. It's the measure of this angle here. Omega is how fast around the circle it is going, and it's similar to a velocity. So you can think of omega as this curve here of it rotating. And then alpha is how quickly it changes how fast it is going, and it's similar to acceleration. The tangent velocity, which we studied earlier in the fall, is this idea that the velocity would come off at a straight line at a constant speed if it were to stop rotating. So that just kind of to throw that out there for what we've studied. Also, frequency becomes something we're going to want to talk about here because as it is rotating, it is coming back to the same point that it has and doing it again and again and again. So it has a sort of periodic motion. And the frequency is the number of revolutions or times around the circle divided by how long it takes to make those times. So the frequency will be in revolutions per second, revolutions per second. Another summary, you can look at these. So here are our linear values, distance, velocity, centripetal acceleration, which we would sometimes call the radial acceleration towards, it's in the direction of the radius, or the tangent acceleration. Then we would have our angular values, which would be the angle theta, the angular velocity, omega, and the angular acceleration, alpha. And remember that we would convert those that way. Now, the only new thing that we really have is this frequency idea that remember, frequency is one over the period. Another way we could think of that is the angular velocity divided by 2 pi. And so we will sometimes or often see this written as omega is equal to 2 pi f, 2 pi frequency. Omega is 2 pi frequency. We measure that in hertz, named after a dude called Hertz. And 1 hertz is one revelation. Re revelation. Oh, I had a revelation. No, one revolution per second or 1 over seconds, which also matches this value for omega because remember, omega is radians per second, and radians really isn't a unit. It's just something we tag onto it. Period then is T. It's the flip-flop or the inverse of it. So it's going to be seconds or seconds per revolution. And then a very common equation that you should know, which is really just this one here, is that the frequency is the inverse of the period, or vice versa, the period is the inverse of the frequency. Notice that we use an uppercase T for that because it is one revolution. So whenever we're dealing with a lot of time, like when we're talking about linear motion, we would use a lowercase t for all of the time involved. But as we're talking about rotating objects, because it's repeating the same cycle, we want to know how much it is for just one of those rotations. And that's why we're going to have a period that is just one of them. So sample problem. A CD has a playing time of 74 minutes. When the music starts, the CD is rotating at an angular speed of 480 revolutions per minute, or RPM. So I'm mentally already thinking, I'm going to have to convert that into a radians per second. I can't leave that in RPMs. At the end of the music, the CD is rotating at 210 RPMs. Again, the same thing. And also now I'm noticing that those are going to be my two velocities, right? Revolutions per minute is the same as radians per second, which is an omega value. So my 480 is going to be my omega I. My 210 is going to be my omega final, and I'm going to have 74 minutes, which is going to be some kind of time that I'll have to convert into seconds, right? So find the magnitude of the average acceleration, the average angular acceleration of the CD, and express your answer in radians per second. So like we said, that's our final. I'm going to convert that by putting revolutions in the bottom and saying one revolution is the same as 2 pi radians. And then to convert my minutes and seconds, I'm going to put minutes in the numerator, so it cancels out with this per minutes in the denominator, and then 1 over seconds. Do the same thing with the 480, and we get a value for that. And then when we convert our time, we get a value of that in seconds. So then the next question then is, if I'm looking for the acceleration, wouldn't I want to have an equation that has a final velocity, an initial velocity, and a time, and an acceleration? And which one is that going to be? Oh, yes, it's going to be that one. Omega F equals omega I plus alpha T. So plug in our values, 22, 50.3, and 4440. And when you solve, that means that the CD is slowing down because it doesn't need to read it as fast, because as it's spinning, the reader is moving in. I don't have a circle thing here for you. The reader is moving in towards the center, which means that it's covering a bigger linear, or a smaller linear distance, so the CD can slow down so that it's not reading it too fast. Next sample problem. A daddy takes his children to the playground and they run over to the merry-go-round and beg to be spun to death. So the daddy gets the merry-go-round traveling at a tangent velocity of 11 meters per second. If the merry-go-round takes 124 seconds to come to a stop, then how many revolutions did the merry-go-round make? So I'm thinking about this. I've got a couple different things here. This is going to be an initial value, but notice that that's in a linear. So I'm going to have to turn that into an angular at some point. I also have a time that it takes. And then since it comes to a stop, I can say that my final omega value is zero, which means my alpha, or my angular deceleration, should be negative because it's slowing down. So I have those, which we just talked about. We want to find theta. How many revolutions did it make? So remember that I can convert from linear to angular and vice versa by using the radius. And it looks like I messed up and didn't give you the radius up in the problem there. So, wow, out of nowhere, this merry-go-round is 2.5 meters. I don't know where that came from. It just happened to be that way. So then if you divide that, you get a radians per second of that 4.4 radians per second. Now, the next thing we can do then is, can't we plug that in to find our alpha value? Because remember, all three of those kinematic equations, you have to know the initial velocity and you have to know the acceleration. And if you don't, then you're going to have two simultaneous equations to get, or you're going to have to use the other variables to solve for those. So the first thing I need to do is solve for A. I can plug in the final velocity is zero, the initial velocity is the 4.4, and the time is 124, and that gives me the deceleration of negative 0.0354 radians per second squared. And then the next would be to plug it into one of the other two kinematic equations to find theta. So I chose the squared ones. I have my final velocity is zero, my initial velocity 4.4, and then squared 2 times that acceleration that we just found up there. And then we can solve for that and say that that is in 273 radians. Now, the interesting part about that is that's not what the question asked us for. We want to know what that is in revolutions. So remember, I'm going to have to do that dimensional analysis, my radians per revolution. So I would divide by 2 pi in order to get that. And that's where I get 43.5 revolutions. So my kids are going to go around that circle 43 and a half times until the merry-go-round finally stops and they get off and probably hurl. So that gives you an idea of kinematics. It is almost the exact same thing. The only thing that's added is there's really just another layer of making sure that our units are in the right values. So making sure that our units are in the right values, which is this radians per second and radians. And then sometimes it will ask you for it in revolutions. So here's our radians per second. Our radians per second is over here. Up here, we have this radians per second squared. And then in the end, notice that we had to convert it back to revolutions because that's what the question asked us for. Otherwise, you're using those three kinematic equations. And that, in a nutshell, is a summary of angular kinematics.